In this section of the series, I'm going to continue building the bearing block here. And these are the plans to the bearing block. And I'll just stop for a moment and let you take a close look at these. Now that we're back, the important dimensions are going to be these three dimensions right here. And over here you can see a side view or more of a finished view of what that boss will look like when it's finished. You've got the platform that sits on the base, and then you've got a outboard boss, and what you can't see is the inboard boss. So this is one side of it. That's the centerpiece of it. Or looking at it this way, you've got a boss that goes out this way, your crankshaft is going to run this way, and you've got an internal boss. The bearing, the measurements are one side of that boss is 5/32, the other boss is 5/16, and this one is 1/8 of an inch. If you add those up together, 5/32, 5/16, and 1/8, convert those to decimal, you've got 5/32 equals 1562, 5/16 equals 3125. 1/8 equals 1250. Add those up, that's 5937 or 594 thousandths. We'll round that up to 594 thousandths. 594 thousandths works out to be the closest fractional size to that will be 9/32. And sometimes, obviously, when you've got fractional dimensions that are given, typically what that indicates, and this is just typically, you can go as close as you want to. You can go right down to the decimal if you need to the thousandths. But normally when you see a fraction like that, you've got a little leeway, one or two thousandths on either side of that. If you see something with, for example, if you see dimensions giving in a fraction, say a half inch, you've probably got two or three thousandths. You can probably run anywhere from, I'm just estimating here, 497 thousandths all the way up to perhaps 503 thousandths in there. And that's not going to affect the running at all. You might see a set of plans that has that on there, or a tenth. Well, usually what you'll do is you'll make it to the next number. In other words, that's closest to a thousandth. If you see something that's in there that has a thousandth on it, for example, 100 thousandths, then in that case, you would go back over, you would want to get that into a half thousandths of dimensions. Now, that's whenever you're machining for total accuracy. Again, we're building a steam engine here, so we're just going to follow the suggestions on the plans, and we do have a little bit of leeway. And then also, you want to take a look at what part that you're building, what function it has. And once again, when you strip away the base or the sole plate, you've got this part right here. All I'm building right here is just a bearing that this will run through. The only real critical dimension on this whole thing is going to be the hole that the crankshaft goes through. And that's why I went to the work of making sure that everything was centered. And this has virtually no play in it. That is a running fit. And that's just exactly what you want to do with a crankshaft. This way that crankshaft will have no knock in it at any RPM that you run. And what brings knock or introduces knock into engines is when you have play in any of the rotating bearing surfaces. And that rotating bearing surface may be this journal here. It could be on the connecting rod end. It could be on the other end of the connecting rod where the wrist pin is, or it could be on either one of those sides of these bearings. If you have much play at all in that, you're going to experience a knock. And the faster the RPM, typically the louder the knock is. So that's why when I'm machining this, I want to be as precise as I can. When I'm going to be machining something that's just going to lay across here, if I'm off 2 or 3 thousandths either side of that, it's not going to affect the running, it's not going to affect the appearance, it's not going to have any effect on it at all. And that's why the plans are calling for fractional sizes, because you don't really have to get it that exact. I'm going to get it as close as possible to 156, 312, and 125, and I'm going to call it good. Let's go over to the lathe and get started. Well, what I'm going to do first is, I'm not going to show this, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this to the milling machine, and I'm just going to mill a flat side on both of these sides, because this is the side that I'm going to start working from. So I'm just going to put this in the milling machine, just run a mill down each side of it, and get that square with the sides. because I'm going to use that to butt up on the jig that was in the last video. I'll see you at the lathe.
Well, I said I wasn't going to film this, but I changed my mind. I'm going to go in and just show you just a couple of ways that I did this and some things to watch out for if you're using a milling machine on this. If you notice, the way I have this mounted in my vise is I've got two parallels that are up underneath here, and I'm just grabbing this by the outside edge of that flat piece. Now, I did not turn it over and go from the bottom side because I don't want anything to slip and the vise jaws press up on the part that I spent all that time machining and reaming. So all the force is going to be on the outside of that piece. So now I've got everything lined up in the milling machine and in the vise. I'm going to go ahead and just cut a straight slice. I don't have to take anything off of it. Once I get a clear cut, I'm going to be done. Then I'll reverse it, and then this will be completed on this part.
There are the two pieces back from the lathe, and they're pretty much right centered, equal pieces. So now remember, that's the reason that I had made, flattened out, or made square both ends, because this is going to be the end here that's now going to go up on the lathe, or the side that the lathe chuck is on, and this will be the side that I first start working on here. So I'll work going from this side over to this side when I mounted up on the lathe fixture that I made in the last video. Before I go on, a little bit of full disclosure here. Last night when I had measured those pieces, I had measured for 11/32 instead of the 19/32. It was late and my memory had got a little bit goofy on me. So when I had made the fixture, I only drilled it enough for a short socket head screw. And in reality, when I came over here, I realized I was going to need a longer socket head screw. Well, I had already threaded this in, and I really didn't want to build another one. So what you can do is just come from the back side of it and just drill a larger drill in it. And that way you've got a through pass on it, and it just opens it up, and you've got just as much strength. One thing that I find people do often, and probably doesn't do any good to do, but I see people doing it often, and that is they often wonder, how deep do you need to thread something to make it strong to stick? Well, my rule is pretty simple. This is 1/4 by 20, and 1/4 by 20 nut is only about 1/4 inch tall. So if I have 1/4 inch or 5/16 threads, I've got plenty of thread in that thing to hold it. So that's what I do. So I've got about 3/8 of an inch of thread. So I don't want to go in and drill it out and make another one and make it deep for that. I just came in the backside and drilled it with a little bit bigger drill than 1/4 inch. I don't remember what drill it was. I just picked a couple down in the drill holder that was a little bit bigger than that. Again, if you're going to be taking stuff in and out of your chuck, pick a chuck jaw. I always pick number one and then mark it with a little punch mark, so when it goes back in there, you can just put it right up under the original jaw and things will be just fine. So we're going to go ahead and put this in and crank it up, and we'll start doing some turning here. All right, so everything is in there. It's already tight. I've got the smooth side up against the machine side over here, and then I've got the unmachined side over here. And now I need to come in 5/32. So I'm going to put a little mark on here. Actually, I'm just going to mark all the way down with my marker. And on this side, this is one that will be coming up also. So get all the sides that are coming up. And then my calipers. And then we'll come in 1/5/16. And mark that. one marked, across the top marked, that one coming up on the outside marked. All right, now I'm going to use my dial caliper to come over here, and then I'm going to my carriage, get it lined up just right. Okay, there's one finished side right there. And all I did is just turn it all the way down till it just started touching that socket screw right there. So now I can take it off, unlock my carriage, I'm gonna take it off, and I'll turn around and I'll do the other side. Now, I'm gonna do one other thing. Since I've got some surfaces now to work with, got this square here, but remember this one right here was not square. So I'm gonna take it now over to the milling machine and put this on a parallel just like that, and I'm gonna come in and just skim the top of that one right there. But I won't show that in the video. It's just gonna be a sitting on a parallel. I'll skim just the top of that little boss right there. That way when I turn it around and put it on, I'll have a nice square setting on it also. I changed belts on this lathe. The lathe on the video is always louder than what it is here. It's really not that loud, but it comes across on that video camera, and it's every camera I've had. This lathe just sounds like it's just falling apart, but it really is pretty quiet. I'm not real sure. But that being said, I broke a belt, and I put a belt on this thing the other day, and it feels like it's just like it's grinding almost. I've checked the tension and everything on it. I believe it's got something on it. I actually put some cleaner on that belt. It's one of those cog belts. I wish it had a V belt, but it's one of those cog belts. And for some reason, it just wants to have that little squeak or something to it. Kind of drives me nuts what it does. Okay, that is two bosses turned. Let's go over to the bench and see how they fit. Well, with a little bit of deburring, that one needs to be run out just a little bit on one end. I'll just do both of them while I've got it. What she looks like. Good, good fit, good tight fit. Good fit, good tight fit. Put it up here, and we're just playing with it right now. Put those in. All right, I've got to go in and trim up, cut down just a little bit of each side of those on the inside of it so the crankshaft will run in there. But they're there, they fit, and the crankshaft turns really, really free. It'll turn better once I get those burrs off of it, and I'll get to do that. I'll have that thing where you can just flip it back and forth. And to tell you the truth, I'm not even real sure that they're paired up. I marked them before I cut them so I'd have them facing the same way that they were in the, and it looks like it's freeing up quite a bit now as they move out and give me some room in there. In fact, the weight of it now will do it. Anyway, that's the crankshaft bearings. And I don't know where I'll go to next. I like to build from the bottom up. I may start the flywheel next, or may just start with the connecting rod and go up through the column. We'll see. Got a few things to do this weekend. Don't know if I'll get a chance to do a whole lot of shop work, but I'll get this one here up here so that so I can get this part of it completed. Hey, thanks for watching, everybody. We'll see you on the next go-round. Start cutting. Again, as always, when you're cutting anything that's off like this, make sure. Something happened to my mark. Let me get it right here. See, I goes in it together. Well, it goes, I've got it backwards. That goes in there, that goes in there like that. I'm probably gonna have to cut some of it down on the inside, as I said.